spoke today with lecturer and author Barry Lituchy. Barry is the founder and director of the Jasenovac Research Institute, which is named after a Croatian concentration camp that was built independently of the Nazis by the Nazi allies of Croatia. Barry is knowledgeable about the development of fascism in Yugoslavia and Ukraine. We started out by asking about the research institute.
Oh, Jasenovac Research Institute. Yes, that's one. That's a nonprofit organization that we established, which is largely devoted to research and publication and commemoration of the Holocaust in Yugoslavia. So, because there never was such an organization before, and when I organized the first international conference in 1997 on this subject, it was apparent that a nonprofit organization devoted to this work was necessary or needed, and had never, you know, its absence was clearly a factor in a lot of disinformation. The fact that there was this vacuum allowed people to distort or cover up or ignore what had been one of the worst, which what had been the worst crimes of genocide ever committed in Southeastern Europe. So that's why we formed the organization Jasenovac Research Institute at the end of 1997, beginning of 1998.
A research institute is not so useful if its information that it uncovers is not put to use. So we asked about how the research can be used.
I mean, I've been involved in a lot of anti-fascist organizations, mostly left-wing organizations, but also sometimes mainstream organizations I've worked with over the decades. In fact, I'm also co-president of a Holocaust organization in New York, which oversees the Holocaust Memorial Park in Brooklyn, New York. And we're having our annual gathering on June 13th, coming up soon, next weekend, in fact, around the theme of the 80th anniversary of the invasion of the Soviet Union and more or less the beginning of the Final Solution, the implementation of the Final Solution in Europe. The summer of 1941. So, but I've spoken at many left-wing organizations, communist, socialist, liberal, progressive events like the Social Scholars Conference, Left Forum, and so on this subject. And perhaps you may have even seen a video of me speaking in the past at one of these events. There's quite a few of them up, I think, from the last 25 years or so.
Right.
So we began to delve into the topic of how the Holocaust and genocide were perpetrated in Ukraine and Yugoslavia.
There are many parallels between Croatia and Ukraine. In both cases, religion played a leading role in dividing the peoples and creating a kind of wedge and a reactionary vehicle for dividing the peoples and conquering the peoples. In both cases, this religious vehicle was dominated by a Western Catholic perspective, and was used by imperial or imperialistic countries, particularly the Austro-Germans. In both Croatia and Ukraine, they supported the growth of a Roman Catholic directed uniate church, backed by thousands of Jesuit priests who tried to undermine the Eastern Orthodox clergy, actually. The best example is the father of Ukrainian fascism, Simeon Petlura, who was himself a seminarian and trying to subvert and carry out this kind of policy within a Russian Orthodox seminary around the turn of the 20th century. He was expelled, and then he turned purely to politics. In Croatia, you had also this Catholic-oriented nationalism, in which the Croats were trying to be accepted as co-equals with at least the Hungarians, if not the German Catholics, within the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And that was promoted by the German, Austro-German leadership. You see the full-blown development of fascism in the 1920s and 30s in both places, taking off as a kind of continuation of this, in Ukraine, it started a little bit earlier, I would say, because during the Russian Civil War, there was an independent Ukrainian government in which Petlura played a very important leading role, and in which they recruited tens of thousands of Ukrainians to this extreme nationalist program, which was anti-Jewish and anti-Russian, and carried out massive pogroms during that period of the Russian Civil War, in which, I've seen estimates of over 100,000 Jews being killed during this period. A short period of the Russian Civil War by these pogroms in the Ukraine. And in the case of the Croatian fascism, that developed a little bit later because the founders of the Croatian fascist movement, Ante Pavelić and Andreja Artuković, who were lawyers in Croatia, were originally financed by Mussolini and the Italians, Italian fascist leadership. But eventually were co-opted by the Germans. In both cases, the Nazis played the most prominent role in organizing the fascists in both the Ukraine and in Croatia. And then, of course, another important parallel is that after World War II, the United States in particular, but the United States and Great Britain, and even to a lesser extent, the West German state, continued perpetuating these fascist organizations, so that there was never a discontinuity. There was always these fascist movements were kept alive and were extremely well organized all through the 1940s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and into the 1990s. And so, were financed by the United States government to a large extent, and were fully recognized as working for the United States government as intelligence gathering and future paramilitary agents, proxies for the Cold War. All of this has to be seen within the larger view frame of US British imperialism in the post-World War II period, that they were part of this global capitalist movement to extinguish any form of socialism or communism in Europe. But that's sort of just an intro.
We discussed some of the legacy which the fascists who escaped World War II have had up until today.
Fascism is like a disease. I mean, it is a political movement that attracts a lot of people from around the world. So during the 1990s, when the government in Croatia under Franjo Tuđman was fighting a civil war in Bosnia, and later carrying out a kind of pogrom against the Serbian population within Croatia itself, Croatian fascist movement played. I mean, there were quite a few people who were still alive who had been leading Croatian Nazis during World War II, who played an important role in supporting that regime, and then of course it attracted all of these neo-Nazis from around the world, from Britain, from Germany, from France, from all over, from the United States as well, of course, and South America. And so it became a kind of center for the further development of neo-Nazi fascist ideology and politics and paramilitary movements. And then after the events in the Ukraine in 2014, the growth of these you know, the Azov battalion and the and right sector and some of these neo-Nazi groups in the Ukraine. You have this, you have again another center for an opportunity for fascists to more or less develop their military as well as political experience, and that, you know, that has long-term implications and long-term dangers for the whole world. So this is a very serious problem, and I don't think it gets enough attention. Of course, the whole picture, a lot of people don't want to look at the whole picture, the fact that this was supported for so long by the CIA and in Germany the BND and MI6 and so on. Sure. It's very funny also, I mean, the way the United States and Britain and even West Germany sort of present themselves as being anti-fascist, and yet secretly, covertly, they're actually enabling fascist political movements to develop. And of course, this serves their foreign policy interests, their long-term foreign policy interests, because these extreme right-wing movements help control or take over regions of Europe that had previously not been under global capitalist control. It helps impose that. If we look at it in terms of the larger picture of things in post-World War II Europe.
We discussed some of the effects of liberal European countries funding Nazis in Ukraine.
Their training ground. It's their university. Their fascist university. I mean, this is they graduate from this if they survive as officers in a future fascist military. They become the political leaders as well of fascist movements. So this is a very important training ground, and it's sad because I mean it's also sad because I if you look at what's going on even in Croatia today, even though there's no fighting going on today, there's still this culture that celebrates the fascists of World War II and their ideology. I mean, in Croatia they still use the Heil Hitler salute, and this, you know, they and it has permeated popular culture with rock and roll bands like Thompson, which sing songs about genocide. Mm. It's hard to believe that goes on in the 21st century, but it does. And this is not at all criticized or monitored apparently by the European Union, even though Croatia is a part of the European Union. And so what this tells you is that the leading powers in the European Union are protecting this kind of far-right fascist ideology and political practice. But to see young people getting involved in that's the thing that's most troubling, because you're basically nurturing a new generation of Nazis or neo-Nazis. Mm-hmm. I mean, the continuity here is really what's most troubling, that the great powers are enabling this continuity to go on, and it's just expanding rather than disappearing.
The discussion moved to German imperialism and the current German state's support for its former Nazi allies abroad.
And, you know, Germany plays a very big part in this, too. Even though Germany did have its own re-education program or of its own Nazis, you know, Germany needs to get some credit for its education of younger generations against Nazism. However, at the same time, it doesn't say anything about the tools or the former colonial outposts of German imperialism, where it also sponsored fascism, like Croatia or even the Ukraine. You know, so it's on the one hand, a German youth might very well understand that the Nazis were a terrible thing for Germany, but they might not understand that the Ustasha or the Croatian fascists were a terrible thing for Croatia or for the Balkans in general, or that the Ukrainian fascists were a terrible thing for the Ukraine. And you know, here's another interesting aspect of this, is that when you come right down to it, the Croats and Serbs and Bosnian Muslims, they're really one people, you know, divided by religion, right? They're really one people. You know, if you do a DNA research of these people, you would find that they share basically the same ethnotypes in terms of same DNA. You couldn't really differentiate a Serb from a Croat or a Bosnian Muslim. And similarly with Ukrainians and Russians, they're really one people divided by religion. And so it's that's also part of the tragedy of it. But it also played in so well to the imperialists. You know, of course, there wouldn't be a Bosnian Muslim population if there wasn't an Ottoman Empire. Wouldn't have been a, there really wouldn't have been a Catholic population if it wasn't for the Austro-German Empire. And so, you know, and similarly in the Ukraine, you wouldn't have had these religious differences if it weren't for the fact that, you know, in the Western Ukraine, really, we're talking about Galicia and Bukovina, those areas of Western Ukraine, which after the starting in the late Middle Ages were taken over first by Lithuania, then by Poland, and then by the Austro-Hungarian Empire in the 1770s. This is where this whole religious division started. I mean, it really was instituted by the Polish government at first, but I mean, by the Polish aristocracy in those regions before the 1700s, but it gathered more strength after the Austro-German takeover of those regions in 1772. And then you have this false consciousness of this division between these peoples when in fact they're really one people, you know.
We spoke about some of the ethnic cleansing in Europe that was led by fascists.
Since 1995, yes. I mean, that was the biggest purge of any people in Europe was when this operation in the summer of 1995, when they purged the Serbian population from the Krajina region of Croatia and also Slavonia. It was about 250,000 Serbs were expelled or killed during that time. Of course, it was at the same time right after Srebrenica and also the NATO bombing of the Bosnian Serbs. So a lot of that was sort of covered up. And then it was followed by the immediate surrender of the Bosnian Serb military after that ethnic cleansing. I mean, but that really was by far the biggest example of ethnic cleansing in Europe since the 1920s. I mean, you have to go back to the time in which the Greeks and the Turks expelled each other from their. There was also after World War II, the expulsion of the German, of the Volksdeutsche in Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia. But even that was smaller in number than the quarter million people expelled from Croatia.
We spoke about the consequences for the people who live in these countries where fascism takes over. For example, Ukraine, where the economy and standard of living have collapsed ever since.
There's a very strong post-communist or communist reaction to this, I think, in among people. But to a large extent, I think it's expressed in emigration and perhaps resignation by a lot of people, because let's face it, global capitalism is the big winner in all of this. And they have success, you know, it's really the global capitalist system that has succeeded the most in Eastern Europe. I mean, you mentioned Croatia and we could also talk a little bit about Slovenia, but in both of those places, which were the first parts of Yugoslavia that were forcibly divided out of Yugoslavia by the Germans, really, by Germany. They were given arms, and then they were given recognition by the German state in 1991. In both of those places, even though the standard of living hasn't gone down, the reality is that these countries have been taken over by German capital. You know, so these were, you know, the industries and including the tourist industry, which was a Yugoslav industry which belonged to the people, has been stolen by German corporations. You know, so you have So the multinationals go in there and they basically rob the people of their economic resources. Perhaps the standard of living hasn't gone down there as much as it, or hasn't gone down like it did in Ukraine after the, in recent years, the Ukrainian standard of living has declined and it's been, the economy has been a disaster. But that's partly because global capitalism hasn't been able to swallow Ukraine, you know. The Ukraine is in a kind of gray zone right now because it's not within totally with under the control of global capitalism. It's not in NATO. It's not in the European Union. It is not fully controlled by multinationals or bilateral trade relations with the capitalist states. So. The Ukraine is in a sense suffering from the fact that it's neither part of Russia's economic orbit or the Western orbit either entirely, not in the same way as Croatia and Slovenia are.
Looking back at the fascist takeover in World War II Yugoslavia, we looked at the history.
Both Germany and Italy had long-term. Goals for expansion into Southeastern Europe. And so both of them had reason to oppose the Yugoslav state that was created at the end of World War I. Italy and Germany, and especially fascist Italy and fascist Germany, which carried out a policy of colonial reconquest, sponsored fascist movements. The Italian fascists, coming to power earlier than the Nazis, already sponsored the Croatian fascist movement, started, as I mentioned earlier, by Pavelić and Artukovic in about 1926, 27, that time period. And they, in fact, were, to a large extent, supported by elements within the Croatian Catholic clergy. So it was also a kind of, it was very much closely associated with a kind of clerical fascism. The Croatian nationalists had for a long time, I mean, one of the main distinctions between Croatian nationalism and say Serbian nationalism was that Croatian nationalism had always sought to be elevated and accepted within German imperialism, whereas Serbian nationalism was certainly anti-German and anti-Turkish. And was seeking to either destroy German colonial control in the Balkans and Turkish control in the Balkans, whereas the Croats were not. They played a very important role in the 1848 revolution in putting down the Hungarians and again in World War I fighting on the side of Austria and Germany, and so there was actually also some racist ideas in Croatian nationalism, even in the late 1800s. But certainly fascism, you know, crystallized all of that, the ideology of fascism, which further developed by the Germans, included eugenics and genocide as a policy. I mean, when we talk about fascism, we have to remember that fascism, one of the defining characteristics of fascism is genocide. It is the idea that certain people must be wiped out. I mean, that's you know, if someone does not agree with that, then that person is not a fascist. I mean, a fascist really truly believes in genocide as foreign policy. Of course, we could say that it's, you know, motivated by economic reasons and geographical reasons, but nevertheless, it's part of the fascist mentality to believe in a kind of murder of killing an entire nation. So Croatian fascism developed in the 1930s. In fact, the Croatian fascists were involved in the assassination of King Alexander when he came to France. I believe that was 1934. And then the Croatian fascist movement, financed first by Italy and then by the German Nazi state, continued to develop. And was heavily financed. And so they, in fact, a lot of the leaders of the Croatian fascist movement who would later play a role in running concentration camps were trained by, you know, in Gestapo and SS institutions. This the same can be said for the Ukrainian fascists too. Many of them were also trained in Germany, in Gestapo and SS institutions in the late 30s. When Yugoslavia at first agreed to join the Tripartite Pact in 1941, and then military officers overthrew the government and rejected the agreement to join the Tripartite Pact, which essentially meant that they would support Hitler and Mussolini in their foreign policy during World War II. Hitler launched a campaign, a military campaign against Yugoslavia in early April 7th, 8th, 9th of 1941, which resulted in the breakup of the Yugoslav state into about 12 different parts. Serbia was under German military occupation. Northern Serbia was given to Hungary. Slovenia was given to the Third Reich. And Croatia and Bosnia were placed under the Croatian fascist political party, the Ustasha, who came to power in early April 1941. And the Ustasha had a policy of basically carrying out genocide against the three ethnic groups that posed the biggest obstacle to their control consisted of almost half the population of Croatia, actually, the Serbs, the Jews, and the Romas, sometimes referred to as gypsies. But these populations, as I said, consisted almost of half the population of Croatia. So you can imagine that a Croatian and of Bosnia. And so you can imagine that a Croatian fascist political movement naturally would want to see those populations wiped out and expropriated, which is in fact what they did do over the course of the next 4 years. They expropriated those populations. The Jewish population was only about, in Croatia and Bosnia together, was about 60,000, as I recall. I think it was about 60,000 Jews in Croatia and Bosnia altogether. Under the Ustasha, about 40,000 of those Jews were murdered. The Roma population, which is often overlooked, and of course, when we talk about the Romas in Yugoslavia, we're talking about really a people who are a nation within country that is has its own language, its own, not necessarily its own religion, because generally they adopted the religion of the locality that they were in. So it could be Islam or Eastern Orthodoxy or Catholicism. But the Romas have their own language, their own culture, and of course they are also the black-skinned people of Europe. So the Roma population is very, even today, is a highly disputed issue. I believe the population was around 100,000. I've seen estimates as low as 30,000, but I do believe it was closer to 100,000. And 98% of the Roma population was murdered by the Croatian fascists. So, and they were often the very first people to be murdered. And they were the ones who were primarily brought to the main concentration camp of Jasenovac in central Croatia, which opened in August of 1941 and ran and was in operation until April 22nd of 1945. Then of course you had the Serbian population. The Serbian population was not entirely killed in concentration camps. They were very often killed in the villages and towns in which they lived. But if they lived in cities, then of course they would be rounded up and brought to concentration camps. The Croats embarked on this policy right from the very beginning of their political ascendancy. When they took power in April of 1941, they began this genocide immediately. And as I mentioned, some of them had been trained by the Nazis in either in the SS or Gestapo institutions, academies. They had direct experience with Nazi training. So as far as the Serbian population is concerned, which was over a million in Croatia and Bosnia, what began almost immediately as a kind of pogroms going from town to town, arrests, There were also mass killings at a place called Jadovno, which is in northern Croatia, in a mountainous area where there were pits where people were thrown in and murdered, mostly Serbs, but also Jews to a large extent. There were quite a few Jews from Zagreb who were killed there. And then, of course, you had the concentration camps, which were established later in 1941. Jasenovac being the main killing, it was really an extermination camp. But all of these concentration camps that existed were big complexes with extensive bureaucracies and economies within these institutions. There was also, I should point out, in Croatia and Bosnia, there were two other groups that to a large extent were allied with the fascists. First of all, there was the Folkdeutsch population, which to a large extent supported, it's a sad fact that Folkdeutsch populations in Yugoslavia and Czechoslovakia were ultimately expelled after the war. Many people suffered, many of these Folkdeutsch did suffer greatly and perhaps mostly undeservedly after World War II. However, the overwhelming sentiment of the German populations in Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, and Poland were pro-Nazi and in the 1930s. So it's not surprising that an entire SS division was created out of the Yugoslav-German population. There was a great division among the Bosnian Muslims because some Bosnian Muslims were not pro-fascist and some were. The Bosnian Muslim state was officially, or the Bosnian Muslim population was considered to be officially part of the political regime in the independent state of Croatia, this Croatian fascist government. So the Bosnian Muslims had their representation, and they also had their, they were also heavily recruited by the Nazis. The Nazis tried to instill an independent kind of Bosnian Muslim nationality. They tried to inculcate this, and to do so, they even brought in the religious leader from Jerusalem. I forgot his name now, but anyway, so they had, and of course, they also created two SS divisions from Bosnian Muslim pro-fascist supporters. The Bosnian Muslim population is interesting because it was not necessarily geared to be pro-fascist, but it was not inclined to be pro-fascist, what I meant to say. But in fact, there was always among the Bosnian Muslims, because they had converted to Islam during the Turkish Ottoman Empire and had been advantaged or benefited from that empire, they tended to be in the elites. They tended to be upper class, financially better off in the upper strata of Bosnian society. So there were quite a few Bosnian Muslims who wanted to adapt themselves to the Croatian fascist regime and did so. Interestingly, the man who later became the president of Bosnia, Alija Izetbegović, had been a Nazi supporter during World War II. He was a teenager at the time, but he had been a political supporter of the Nazis. And this was kept secret all through the 1990s until he died. And it was only revealed after he died that he had been, in fact, a Nazi in World War II. But that's not so surprising because he was a very vehement anti-communist political opponent during the Tito period and had written books calling for an Islamic state in Bosnia in the 1970s and had been under arrest for many years. So it's not entirely surprising that he had that earlier Nazi connection. But in any case, during World War II, the Croatian fascists carried out this genocide. It was, in a way, necessary to fulfill the dreams of Croatian extreme nationalism, to expand. Actually, the policy toward the Serbs was deliberately called: we will convert a third, we will expel a third, and we will kill a third. That was the official policy toward the Serbian population. And not just Serbian children, but also Jewish children were forcibly converted to Catholicism under the Croatian fascist regime. One of the worst aspects of all of this is that the Catholic Church, and now we're talking about the Vatican in particular, and Pope Pius XII, They were fully aware of what was going on in Croatia. They knew that this that this fascist genocide was going on with the full complicity of the Catholic Church, and yet this part of the story is not fully taught or even agreed to by most scholars today, or by many scholars today. Although I think it's quite clear, it's even more clear when we see how at the end of World War II, as the fascist regimes were losing the war, and there was an already in place policy for escape not just for the Nazis themselves, but for their collaborators. And when we talk about the Holocaust, we really should talk about not just the Nazis and not just the Jews, but also the Nazis and their collaborators, the Jews and other victims of fascism. I mean, that really, because the Holocaust has to be considered not just a Jewish event, but a historical event. It's part of the history of the 20th century and part of the history of imperialism, in fact. And we should view it as such in a secular and a non-denominational sense. Now, having said this, I should also point out there were Bosnian Muslims who were anti-fascist, and there was also a very significant Croatian anti-fascist movement as well. They were often not killed at first. The Ustasha did not, the Croatian fascist party, the Ustasha political movement, did not necessarily want to exterminate the Croatian anti-fascist, Croatian communists, although they were all imprisoned. A lot of them ended up, of course, being killed, particularly in Jasenovac, by the last days of Jasenovac. Male and female Croatian communists and Slovenians were ultimately murdered in the camp. Oh, I just wanted to add one other thing. The fact that the Catholic Church has such an enormous responsibility for this, not to mention Germany. German responsibility and the Catholic Church's responsibility is obviously enormous, because without either of them, there could not be a Croatian fascist movement. Or there couldn't have been a genocide in Yugoslavia. But the Catholic Church prepared, you know, it was within the institutions of the Catholic Church that the escape of the Nazis was organized. And that, of course, became known famously or infamously as the Rat Lines. The Rat Lines, which started in the Vatican, and in particular buildings that we know, the San Romeo and some of these other places where they were actually hiding out, and that US and British intelligence knew about, and that they then were allowed exile to South America, sometimes Canada and the United States even, as well as there were some cases of Ireland as well. I think Artukovich went to Ireland at one time, in fact. This was all organized through the Catholic Church and their responsibility for, and this is of course during the time of Pope Pius the XII, who was still Pope into the late 1950s. To this day, I don't think people recognize how devastating and destructive this was. And even in Germany, they don't understand their responsibility for what happened in Yugoslavia. This has been covered up to a large extent. But when you think about what the Rat Lines entailed, and the whole story of the Rat Lines was largely unknown to the public until the 1980s. It was only when you may be too young to remember this, but in the 19 I remember when Klaus Barbie was arrested in South America, and then he more or less exposed this story of how the Rat Lines operated. That was in the mid to late 1980s that whole story exploded, that this is how fascism was kept alive and preserved and even further expanded after World War.
And we brought the discussion back to the modern day.
It's central to our world, really. It's central to the Western world. The Western world, is defined by global capitalism, by imperialism, and by fascism. And they're all interconnected, and they are all part of the most tragic events of the 20th and even early 21st century. So we are still living in that history. We're living in that history today. Even it hasn't ended, and we have to be aware. Those of us who are anti-fascists, and we hope to win most of the people of the world to that viewpoint. We have to be knowledgeable about the history of this fascism, what it has done, and how to combat it.
We discussed some of the intelligence agency's role in nurturing fascism.
They were paid by the CIA as well, and MI6. They're being paid to do these things. BND. I mean, German intelligence, British intelligence, American intelligence. They're paying these fascists, these Nazis, all through the 1950s, 60s, 70s, and 80s. They're on the payroll, and the U.S. spent billions of dollars on this. You know, imagine if billions of dollars had been spent for something good. You know, I mean, we wouldn't be using oil or polluting the environment so much if we had spent billions of dollars on good things for humanity and for the planet.
Yeah, but I suppose just to say, like, it's not like it's a really fascinating history, but it's not a dead history. It's like
living history,
yeah, or like, you know, how history doesn't repeat but it rhymes or whatever. Like, you know, these guys will be activated. The same people, like, you know, the same kind of handlers, like, so they'll try to do the same thing again.
Well, I mean, the events in the Ukraine are just, you know, they're just years old. I mean, it's just a very recent events, and so we see the Azov Battalion and Right Sector and these groups drawing on the global fascist periphery or movements and drawing them in and then committing these atrocities. You know, when the Yanukovych government was overthrown in 2014, and the new right-wing Ukrainian government, which was really created by the United States, you know, that was when the Undersecretary of State, what was her name? I forgot her name now.
Oh yeah, Victoria Nuland.
Victoria Nuland, who is again back in her old job, and the U.S. Ambassador to Ukraine basically were choosing the government of the post Yanukovych government. I mean, they installed this right wing government that then allowed the paramilitary. Oh, and they one of the very first things that they did was they outlawed the Russian language and declared that only Ukrainian was so in other words, they came out right away with this this very racist political program, very similar to what Petlura did back in 1917-1918. He outlawed Russian and declared the Jews to be a foreign enemy and so on. This is history repeating itself, but really, or continuing itself, and we're living this history. I mean, it's going on. The crimes that they committed in Odessa in recent years, and killing union activists and burning down their union hall and union building, and basically terrorizing the population. This is all part of the immediate history that we're living in. And I don't know, you know, I don't. I think at the very least we must educate people to what's actually going on. That these are proxies for U.S. and global capitalist imperialism, and that they are trying to bring the Ukraine into the global capitalist system, and that's their role, and they'll do that through war if necessary. You know, so it's, you know, and very interestingly, the guy who was taken in that airplane recently by the Belarusian government, I forget his name now, but a week ago, he was, it turns out he was himself a fascist. I don't know if he was part of this Azov Battalion and had participated in the Ukrainian right-wing political movement, even though he's Belarusian. But, you know, perhaps that's, you know, as we said earlier, this is a training ground. This is a university or academy for players who want to be in, you know, agents of foreign intelligence movements and carry out violent acts against populations and governments in the name of global capitalism.
Absolutely. For example, that the Russian guy has been, the Belarus has been sanctioned across the European Union from it. But, like, you know, even here in Ireland, all the political parties, including the so-called left socialist ones, were condemning him as a political prisoner. But yeah, he was a Nazi. It's very unfortunate that. I don't know. I mean, I don't know what to say. It's just unfortunate that the people will, in theory, not accept fascism themselves, but they'll, you know, as soon as a fascist goes abroad, they call him a freedom fighter. It's just quite unfortunate. But
it's part of it's an ideological struggle. The ruling elites naturally are, they have their ideology, which is imbued with this idea of human rights, which is on the face of it, actually a very good thing. And I think we all support human rights because human rights really is a continuation of the idea of democratic rights and the rights of people to have equal and universal rights, you know, equality of peoples. But the capitalist system uses this ideology in a very cynical way, opportunistically, when it can weaponize it for its own foreign policy goals. And I teach a course on human rights at Brooklyn College here in New York. And I think that whenever I believe in human rights. It's just that human rights is weaponized by global capitalism to attack those that oppose its global reach and goals. And so it's very confusing to the average person. You know, it's very confusing to the average person when you hear your own government saying, we support human rights, but we believe that we have to take action against the government of Belarus because they're violating human rights. But the truth of the matter is it really in the interest of human rights for the European Union and the United States to impose sanctions on the people in Belarus and against the government of Belarus and to basically take away their own self-determination? I don't think so. And I think that's where we have to begin to question the way in which human rights is presented to the people, in the
discussion then turned to how did the countries of Yugoslavia and the USSR deal with and teach the legacy of genocide inflicted on the people living there?
It's one of the most complex issues in all of 20th century history, because I guess where we have to begin is with the agreement that was made between the Soviet Union, the United States, and Great Britain during the war in 1943, called the Moscow Agreement. The Moscow Agreement was an agreement between the three allies in World War II that war criminals, and the word genocide had not yet been coined because it wasn't coined until after World War II, war criminals would be arrested by all of the Allied powers, and that they would be sent back to the countries in which they committed those crimes to be tried by the people in those countries. So, in other words, if German fascists or Croatian fascists had been captured, they should have been returned, or Ukrainian fascists should have been returned. Of course, that didn't happen because the United States and Great Britain, almost from the very beginning, almost from the very start after World War II, actually helped liberate the war criminals that they thought would be useful to them in the post-war period as intelligence agents or possibly military agents. And so now, as far as Yugoslavia and the Soviet Union, Yugoslavia was allied with the Soviet Union in 1945. Obviously, the Yugoslav Communist Party had more or less been reorganized by Stalin in 1932, and the leadership that led the anti-fascist movement in Yugoslavia under Tito was basically the same leadership that came into the leadership of the Yugoslav Communist Party in 1932. The Yugoslavia and the Soviet Union were closely allied all the way until 1948. It was as a result of the breakup between Yugoslavia and the Soviet Union that Yugoslavia eventually not only broke with the Soviet Union, but in fact began to play a role as a kind of wedge between the Soviet and other Eastern European communist countries and the West. And now, so on the one hand, what this means is that Yugoslavia did try to punish the Nazi and Ustasha and other collaborative war criminals to the fullest extent, which meant death, really. I mean, at the very end of World War II, thousands of fascists were captured by the communists and killed at a place called Bleiburg, and that has been a rallying point for neo-Nazis ever since. There were annual events held there by neo-Nazis or Nazis until just about 2 years. I think 2019 it was outlawed by the Austrian government. But the policy changed considerably after 1948 because of the conflict between Stalin and Tito. And Stalin wanted Tito removed from power. Tito and his supporters within the Yugoslav Communist Party did not want that. And so they purged the Yugoslav Communist Party of pro-Moscow elements. A lot of them, perhaps 1,000 or so, were sent to a prison island called Goli Otok, and many of them were killed there, actually. That was actually the worst human rights abuse of Yugoslavia in its entire history, as far as the communist Yugoslavia is concerned. The official policy of the Yugoslav Communist Party from the very beginning was always bratstva I jedinstva, which meant brotherhood and unity. And so you could say on the one hand that the desire to create a multinational society and country where there was really respect and love between the various nationalities, and there was great, you know, there was even a great deal of intermarriage and families who really considered themselves Yugoslav. I mean, there were millions of people in Yugoslavia who considered themselves Yugoslav, not Croat, Slovene, or Serb, or whatever, but they were Yugoslav because they were of mixed marriages and mixed family backgrounds. There was this, on the one hand, this very positive thing of trying to create a multinational country. However, the policy of anti-fascist punishment re-education of the population did change dramatically after 1948. And that's most, you know, it's clear in a couple of cases where there was, you know, there were a couple of very high profile cases in Yugoslavia. For example, the Archbishop Stepinac, who was considered to be a kind of hero of the fascist movement because he was a fascist and he had been part of the fascist Ustasha government in the independent state of Croatia. His trial was more or less altered, or the whole course of his trial altered from him facing the death penalty to essentially being under house arrest and a very permissive kind of kind of caving in by the Yugoslav Communist Party to U.S. and Western demands for leniency toward the fascists. The U.S. and Britain did not try to repatriate these Nazi war criminals, whether they were German or Croat or Hungarian or Bosnian Muslim or whatever. They didn't try to repatriate them, and said they protected them. And this went as far as also pressuring Yugoslavia to agree to leniency towards these anti-fascists. So the whole policy of Yugoslavia after 1948, yes, there was this positive element of brotherhood and unity, which certainly on its own is a very positive and good thing. It was a communist slogan. It was a socialist slogan that there should be brotherhood and unity among people of the working class, of anti-fascists, and certainly that was represented in the Yugoslav anti-fascist movement too. But on the other hand, there was this other element where the state of Yugoslavia began to make deals with the United States and Britain and the European Union, or what European Council, whatever it was called before, to basically this permissiveness and this failure to provide the kind of anti-fascist education and punishment and clarification about what had gone on. So there was a failure on the part of the Yugoslav state to come to terms with it, with the elements of fascism that had existed within it and that had the possibility of being reborn again in the 1990s, which is what happened, of course. The Soviet Union, on the other hand, did have a pretty strong policy, clear policy. I mean, there was a great literature that came out of the Soviet Union and other communist countries explaining what the fascists had done. And although it may not have been clear enough about some of the historical elements of it, I think you know, there's certainly some room for criticism, but on the whole, it was a positive anti-fascist education that existed in the other communist countries, or at least in the Soviet Union. Now, in the post-communist period, we have a really big problem because there is a total whitewashing in many of these countries of what happened under fascism. So, for instance, in the Baltic states, you have the celebration of a lot of the fascists who participate. I mean, in Lithuania, this is a very big problem, to a lesser extent, also in Estonia and Latvia, where the where extreme nationalists were, in fact, pro-Nazi and carried out genocide policies during when Barbarossa was carried out. You know, people don't realize this, that even though Hitler never signed a law saying we're going to carry out genocide against the enemies of the Nazi state, and the Jews and Russians and Serbs were always considered enemies of the Nazi state rather than, you know, targeted nationality groups for extermination, except, you know, Wannsee Conference. But these pro-Nazi elements in Eastern Europe are today who collaborated with the extermination of Jews and communists and Russians and Serbs, they are being celebrated today in a lot of places, not just in the Baltic states, not just in Croatia, but even in other Eastern European countries, and to some extent in Poland too. So this is a very big problem.
It is necessary to remember that fascism in Yugoslavia and Ukraine was defeated by Yugoslav and Ukrainian communists and patriots.
What we need to remember is that the partisans, the Yugoslav communist partisan movement, was a multinational movement. It was a movement that overcame all of the ethnic national divisions, whether it be religious or national or cultural, that existed between Serbs, Croats, Jews, Bosnian Muslims, or even Albanians for that matter. It unified those people in one national movement. By the way, Tito really believed that he could unite Yugoslavia with Albania. That was one of Tito's great sins against Stalin, actually. But in any case, and of course that's a whole nother issue. We could talk about that forever. But similarly, the Red Army represented that in the Soviet Union. The Red Army was the reason why not all the Jews of Europe were exterminated. Anybody who is of Jewish background and doesn't recognize the enormous role that the Red Army played in saving the lives of millions of Jews in Europe, as the arch imperialist Churchill said, the Red Army tore the guts out of the Nazi war machine. That was one of his quotes. One of his good quotes. Mm-hmm. But I'm fully aware of his anti-Irish history. But the Red Army played a similar role. You know, so many Jewish families in Russia, Belarus, Ukraine, were completely wiped out, except for the members of the family that fought in the Red Army or that were saved by the Red Army. You know, it's just, and of course the Russian population also, so the Soviet Union of course suffered terribly, over 20 million people killed by the Nazi war machine. But ultimately it was the Red Army that saved entire nations in Europe. And that has to be remembered and respected.
Croatian communists and anti-fascists, of course, played a role defeating the Ustasha.
Absolutely. In fact, there were the underground movement in the Jasenovac concentration camp was led by a Croatian communist. The Croatian communists saved a lot of lives of Serbs, Jews, and Romas. Unfortunately for the Romas, they were almost totally obliterated, 98% of them. But as far as Serbs and Jews were concerned, a lot of them were saved by Croatian communists. And so that's also something that people need to recognize. And that, again, points to the absolute necessity of this kind of multinational, international solidarity You know, that's in the final conclusion of things, that's maybe the only thing that can save people, you know, that can save persecuted individuals or groups.
Yeah, you know, no, exactly. It's stuff we can build on in the future as well. We have this legacy, you know, it fits in with, it can build the story and the narrative and all the rest of it that we need to build for today. But I guess, yeah, just in terms of the, I guess what these countries, these socialist states did, like after following like World War II, where it just to say, I suppose it is like a very difficult problem that they had, like I would imagine that they had.
You know, it's yes, absolutely. You know, people don't recognize that it was really the communist countries were always under assault from day one. And, you know, this can be proven by just reading CIA documents. You know, they're available now. Much of them have been declassified and published, although there's, you know, there's a lot that's blacked out. But still, you can read these documents and you can see quite clearly this was there was an assault on these communist countries, a violent assault using paramilitary units to try to overthrow or create, complete destabilization in these countries to undermine and sabotage their economic development as well. And it's hilarious when people say that, well, NATO was created to protect Europe. NATO was created 6 or 7 years before the Warsaw Pact was created. Why, if NATO was created to protect Europe from communism, then why was it created long before any kind of communist military organization was created years before? You know, it's a kind of perversion of history that that people don't recognize this that the communist countries were constantly being destabilized and under attack and in a very difficult situation that their whatever problems they did have to a large extent could be laid at the feet of the imperialist countries who were trying to strangle them.
And then of course like NATO was a military alliance supposedly, but I believe that the Gladio program was a NATO project, a secret NATO project of directly like having fascists, like arming fascists. But I suppose the difficulty that I was going to say about the specific problem that these socialist countries had was I guess at different points they might well have had, like in terms of the millions of people were killed, but that required lots of people to do the killing, like who were involved and culpable. So like they would have had, like I believe even in the 1920s, let's say in the Soviet Union, they would have hundreds of thousands at least of people who'd been like directly done murders or done close to that. And then again, like after World War II, like, I mean, I suppose just to say that it's a difficult problem, like the overall goal of brotherhood and unity, trying to achieve that. But if you have to live with people, if in the service of that, the socialist states decide to kind of try to wipe out or wash out some of the history of the victim because it's too difficult and I mean, I don't know to what extent this happened, but I guess if having lots of people who could have been culpable, like large populations who were culpable of murder and war crimes against their neighbors, it's hard to build like the society of justice or of unity and brotherhood if your victimhood hasn't been if you haven't gotten justice for that.
It wouldn't have been as difficult if it weren't for the fact that the extreme reactionary political movements were kept alive by the superpowers, the United States, Britain, Germany, and the West. If they hadn't kept those far right political movements alive, it would have been much more difficult for those movements to then be resurrected in their countries of origin. You know, it was a matter where, they did the best that they could to exterminate these fascist movements, but at the same time, and they were outlawed for sure. Even in Yugoslavia, this was against the law. However, it was not really possible to completely eliminate it because there were always these outside forces who were perhaps even traveling into the country, penetrating the country, and perpetuate and carrying out this political activity on behalf of this extreme ultra-nationalist or fascist politics. You know, that was the real problem. And so, when we think about the extraordinary extent to which some of the communist countries, you know, try to provide security for themselves, we have to realize that even with all that security, that it was poor. Their borders were porous. Actually, the secret agents, the fascists, were able to penetrate that security. It was not foolproof by any means.
We discussed some of the evolution of ideology which led to support for fascism.
You know, it's a very funny thing that, the United States was at one time a very anti-Catholic country. You know, it persecuted the Irish considerably in the 19th century and had this very harsh, you know, it was founded by people who were very anti-Catholic, in an extreme way, the United States. And yet, after World War II, the thinking in the United States changed considerably because the Catholic Church became sort of part of the imperialist system. You know, it was incorporated into the Cold War politics. And so, you know, that's why we had the Polish Pope, and we had, you know, the Catholic Church supported, and eventually the United States in the early 1980s recognized the Vatican as an independent country, which, you know, would have been unthinkable in earlier periods in American history where there was extreme anti-Catholic sentiment, you know. So
I think, I don't know, I'm not sure, like, half the reason for that is that if they can, if they're an independent country, they can give out passports and they can do diplomatic missions and without having their bags.
Oh, sure. I mean, the Catholic Church was a great vehicle for U.S. foreign policy in the Cold War. I mean, it was a great, it was sort of an underground network of, and you know, so many of the anti-communists in the 1980s were in one way or another connected with the Catholic Church. I mean, it was just, and of course, then again, you also have the way in which the Catholic Church, you know, was drawn into a lot of, I mean, the fascist movement, U.S. imperialism, and so on. You know, I don't think it's ever stopped unleashing fascism. I mean, as we know in the Ukraine, it's still using fascism, and in Croatia, the old Croatian fascism is still alive and kicking. And I think, and also, you know, it's very interesting, to some extent, the United States and Great Britain have no, and the rest of the global capitalist system has no problem with Islamic fundamentalism either, you know, because it doesn't interfere with capitalism, really. You know, Islamic fundamentalism is not anti-capitalist. So if Islamic fundamentalism decides to take over in Afghanistan and prevent women and girls from going to school, I don't think capitalism is going to have any problem with that. You know, even though I think if you believe in human rights and you believe in equal and universal human rights, which is really the only sense in which human rights make sense, then you would have a very big problem with this.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I guess it would be a good thing to get more people to this understanding. Like, they should kind of flip their, you know, a lot of, like, I, you know, the default perspective you would have is that growing up, you'd get a storyline that capitalism and liberalism is the best way of everything, and then the totality, the evil ideologies of communism and fascism want to destroy that somehow. But it just, if people were to flip that around, they would.
It's false consciousness. I mean, people are easily manipulated because they believe that they live in a quote democracy, which to a large extent is also not real, because, you know, if you're living in a capitalist democracy, you're living in a society in which the political elites are essentially an oligarchy anyway. They're not really, they don't really represent the larger population. That's true in the United States anyway, and I think in most of the capitalist world. And you also believe that you're living in a society that believes in human rights and justice. And of course, you know, there might be all kinds of movements to educate people along these lines, like Germany did, you know, educated people against Nazism. And yet Germany enabled the rebirth of Nazism and is still playing a very negative role in Eastern Europe today, and maybe trying to destabilize Russia and trying to support the Ukrainian far right. And the Belarusian far right. So, you know, I mean, certainly Marxism plays a very important role in educating people as to the economic foundations of political systems. You know, that there is a ruling class or ruling elite who manipulate ideas to their benefit, as any ruling class would. Of course, they want to impose their power not through coercion, but through cooperation. And you do that by fooling people into believing things that are not necessarily in their interests. And this is very often done through religion and mysticism, but it can also be done through, you know, just trickery, you know, like saying we believe in human rights, but we will support human rights where we feel it's in our interest to support it, and we will not support it where it's not in our interest to support it. So, you know, and of course, only after a lot of suffering pedophilia and child abuse and in the Catholic Church recognized in the United States and in other countries.
And so the discussion moved to the context which fascism is developing in now.
Really incredible what happened here, and still though I don't think it's even fully been exposed. But I think that, you know, if we understand, you know, as I getting back to the ideas of what the important aspects of Marxist education is, that it does teach us how the economic foundations of a society determine the political and cultural institutions to a large extent. The fact that, I mean, so that's why we need to understand that we do live in a global capitalist world in which, you know, which is different than the world that produced the most virulent forms of fascism in the pre-Bretton Woods period, okay? I mean, we live in the Bretton Woods period of capitalism, of imperialism. Bretton Woods was that meeting in 44, which basically established the skeletal framework for global capitalism in the post-World War II period. And this is a different kind of imperialism, where multinationals more or less carry out their economic activities with the support of governments and international agencies. And of course, nowadays, where a lot of the so-called global North countries are, the exploitation of the global North countries is somewhat covered up by the fact that the global South is more heavily exploited than in the global North. In the period before Bretton Woods, before World War II, we were still living in the age of high imperialism, in which there were competing empires trying to divide up the world, as Lenin explained in his book on imperialism. The world was, that was a different kind of imperialism than the kind of imperialism that we have today, where global capitalism is kind of united in an effort to exploit the whole world to the benefit mostly of the developed countries, you know. So
exactly, and just there's a good, I mean, just specifically for some of these ex, you know, there's lots of different kinds of fascists in the world, but some of the ex-Nazi or the current Nazi people from who were the Nazi collaborators, I guess one of the contradictions that they're facing, these guys who are so-called nationalists in theory, but all that they can offer people is, you know, in all their countries, they've sold everything in their country, in their nation, off to, you know, global, international.
Right.
Like,
that's
know.
Right. I mean, it's tragic. You know, Yugoslavia, even though it was not the same kind of communist or economy or socialist economy as the Soviet Union, had this, it had its own kind of system, kind of market socialism, where there were state-run enterprises, worker cooperative enterprises, and also capitalist enterprises, these three different levels of economic organization, which actually functioned rather well, and were very much successful in enabling the people to build up their country from what was a third world country into a developing country, a rapidly developing European country. but of course, that the dependency that occurred really started in communist times, when Yugoslavia, thinking that they could still have this special status in the Western world as kind of a bridge between the communist and capitalist world, people in Yugoslavia really believed that this would go on forever. Of course, it didn't go on forever. Once the Soviet Union and the other communist countries were gone, there was no longer a need for the Western capitalist system to support Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia could be destroyed and broken up into these mini states, which are more easily exploited. I mean, that's why the Serbs were targeted in the 1990s as the enemy in the Yugoslav civil war, is because the Serbs wanted to preserve Yugoslavia for the most part. They were they had the most to lose by the breakup of Yugoslavia. To some extent, the Bosnian Muslims, there were a lot of Bosnian Muslims who also wanted to preserve Yugoslavia. There were a lot of Croats who wanted to preserve Yugoslavia. But the extreme nationalists among the Slovenians, Croats, and Bosnian Muslims wanted to break up the country and become essentially the new ruling elites in their mini states. And this this is what defined, I mean, it was globalization that defined the global capitalist onslaught against Yugoslavia is what defined the political conflict in the 1990s. It's true that Yugoslavia really also got itself into trouble by taking out too many loans to the global capitalist system, to the IMF and World Bank. You know, this is why I say we're in the same, we're basically in a 1944 to present kind of capitalist system. Yes, you could say there was a big distinction between, say, 1940s to 1980s and 1990s to the present. You know, there's like, you know, we moved from a period of where the capitalist world was creating a system of dependency now to a system of like what historians and economists, Marxist economists of today would call, or not even necessarily Marxist, but capitalist economists would call global labor arbitrage, where, you know, the multinationals move to the places where there's low wage labor to exploit. But this was done also within the European Union with the communist countries. They broke up Yugoslavia so they could create these little mini states that could be easily dominated by the European Union and exploited by the multinationals. And that's the result of the destruction of Yugoslavia. And
absolutely, yeah. And just to say that, I think that this can be the basis for future anti-fascism in these places, in that these fascists who have taken over the places have also, like, you know, they have no option but to sell off the entire the living conditions, which means all of the wealth of the country, and so the living conditions for ordinary people are terrible. So anyway, just that hopefully that will be the basis for that.
That would be the basis for a new kind of socialist unification and leadership, I think, in the former Yugoslavia, but also in Eastern European countries in general, and presumably also within the former Soviet countries too.
Mm. Yeah, at least in
Russia, Ukraine. I mean, there's no reason for the Ukrainians and the Russians to hate each other. They're really one people, and the sooner they overcome this, the better, because they really should be working together rather than against each other. And so that's why a socialist political movement that recognizes that, I think, would be very, very important for this region.
Finally, Barry summed up the reasons for doing anti-fascist research.
See, I would like to see more of this. I mean, obviously, the whole project of commemorating the struggle against fascism and also the victims of fascism, I think this is a practical thing for progressive people to do, and to understand that racism is really the product of, all forms of racism are really the product of imperialism, that this is... that one form of exploitation leads to another, and that we should be working for a more just and socialist society in the future, and that I would hope could be the starting point for an alternative to the political systems that we have today, because the global capitalism, I don't believe, is going to bring about a more just society, and I think it's in the process really of creating more divisions. So I do believe that a fundamental aspect of a progressive socialist program has to include a strong education in anti-fascism, in understanding the history of fascism as a product of imperialism, and also that the lessons of the anti-fascist struggle are extraordinarily central to the education of a socialist movement in the future, a progressive, just society in the future.
Many thanks to Barry for taking the time to do this interview. You can find more of Barry Lituchy's research on jasenovac.org. And he has an updated edition of his book to be released this year.